Welcome back. Welcome back to the API documentation, dev portals, and complexity track. The next speaker is going to be Radu Popa, who is the CTO at LuxHub, who's going to talk about the connective tissue of open finance. Radu is he's been focusing on platform as a service and API architecture in distributed systems. So that's the perfect shoe-in for some of the topics that we've had already this morning. Radu, with that said, please welcome and go ahead, take it away.
Well, thank you, Christoph. I hope I can be heard fine. Thank you for having me here and for giving myself and LuxHub the opportunity to have our say on this subject. Conferences like this, I think they put together a lot for us. So I'll just go to the agenda first, very fast, and then go to the actual content of the presentation. So as you can see, the title is The Connective Tissue to Open Finance. This is what we aim to do by our initiative around marketplace and platform development. I will go first to a little bit of presentation of the landscape around this area. Then about things that are working and not working so great in the area of open finance, what can be done, what we propose to do, and what is basically our timeline to put this into practice. So I will start by introducing a little bit LuxHub. LuxHub, it's a company that was created about 3 years back. We were created by four major retail banks in Luxembourg with the initial idea to become a company that is implementing compliance-related items that the banks are exposed to. We started with the PSD2 regulation. We implemented that for our shareholders and then begin to sell the solution that we develop to other customers. So we moved from there to became also a regulated AISP PISP provider in Luxembourg in the condition of PSD2, and also to be recognized by EBA in June 2019 as the second largest European open banking hub in the context of PSD2 and open banking in general, of course. We have about 60 customers in 10 countries, all in the European Union. And we managed basically to transcend a little bit our initial mission of being a compliance solution provider for our shareholders, to sell the solution, to begin developing new things based on the same infrastructure that we built for the compliance solution. So what did we see as part of this journey? Well, we were really witnessing firsthand this open banking phenomenon and how it is moving and evolving towards open finance. We see that it is really indeed a global phenomenon driven by regulations or driven by the industry. It is now a global thing all over the place. In Europe, obviously, we have the PSD2 regulation of the European Union. We have the Open Banking UK initiative in the United Kingdom. We have various other players in the countries that are not part of the European Union. We see this organized by the industry themselves, like we see it in Switzerland, for example, by our partners in SIX. We see it in other countries, again, across the world as a market initiative, as a regulator push, as in scope that is less or more than what we see in Europe. We have, for example, in Australia, the legislation there, it's actually a lot more comprehensive than just account information and payment accounts. There are a lot more topics that are addressed. So we see that everything is moving. It is a very, very dynamic sector, I would say. And it is moving from this early adoption to legislative imposition towards all the shapes and formats that are on the way. So the synergies become now to be quite present in this area. The market begin to stabilize a bit. We see new services that are developed. We see new type of accounts that are made available via open banking, new type of services that are built on top of these rails. We see initiatives developing in areas that are not traditionally as part of open banking. So we have open wealth, we have open insurance. We can almost talk about open anything. Basically, I've seen recently an initiative in open energy, in the same concept that was established for open banking. So there is a huge amount of entropy that is developing in the area. There are more and more legislative proposals in this direction. There are more and more market initiatives. And basically, we are talking here about a very, very dynamic sector with traction from a lot of players, the traditional players. And I named the financial institution, the traditional finance institution, the banks mostly, right? And the newcomers into the area. We have fintechs, we have tech companies, we have now the regulated third-party providers that are all over the place. And this kind of participation basically generate new type of services that are developed, new type of offerings that are made in this context. And we should not definitely forget about the end users, being them actual individuals and users or corporate users. There are a lot of new services that are offered. There are initiatives and efforts in the direction of providing a better service. Also, a very important play in all this in all this conundrum is made by the hubs. Right, we have the so-called integration hubs, like LuxHub, hence the name. Right, that are providing services as API aggregators or as platform technical service providers. In our case, particularly, we started, like I said, as a technical service provider for the banks that needed to publish their compliance API in the context of PSD2 regulation. While meantime, we evolved to get our own TPP license to publish our own API aggregation services in the account aggregation area, into the payment initiation area, beginning now to build a more advanced services on the same rails of open banking. So, like I said, there is a lot of movement here. There are a lot of initiatives. And obviously, there are good parts in all this. There are bad parts, and there are things that are missing. And my talk today is basically proposing to focus on this missing link, the tissue that we still need to grow around this ecosystem in order to make it successful and beneficial for all the participants. So what was working well so far? Well, there are a lot of things that work well. We have legislative frameworks. We have the classic example of PSD2 in Europe. We have the open banking in the UK. These are extending, right? And they are getting tractions. We have a lot of market initiatives. These are already, we see them expanding by, beyond compliance, right? So we have the standards that are created, for example, for PSD2, that now they are extending the services that are offered via these standards. So they are going outside the normal scope that they are created for, and they propose new type of services, new type of accesses, new type of resources that can be shared in this kind of ecosystem. There are also an increasing number of participants, and there are more and more third-party providers that get regulated, that get to participate in the game. And there is a lot of traction coming from this direction. The voices of these participants are more and more important, and they need to be listened. They influence the services that are delivered. They influence the quality of the service that is delivered. The products that are coming to the market are more and more sophisticated. So if we look, we see that the regular account information services or even the basic payment initiation that we have described in open banking, they kind of becoming commodities already. There are so many offerings in this direction that they begin to compete only in price. And becoming commodities, it means that they will be always the basis for other services. So other services, more sophisticated, will begin already to be built on top of that. We see the number of transactions increasing a lot. And we finally see the lines between consumers and providers that are blurring. a very good example is the first consumers of the account aggregation services are the banks themselves. So basically they aggregate other banks. By and the purpose of that is to offer in their platform services that are normally offered by their competitors. And in doing so, basically get a competitive edge. So what are the growing pace? Well, still quite a lot as well. There is still a very heavy fragmentation due to all these non-harmonized and non-standard approaches that are taken. There is standardization, but not to the level that we like to see it. There is still lack of engagement between the participants, and there is no service guarantee, well, except for the compliance solution, right? So basically, the compliance, we can say that is working quite well and it's improving, but most of the other initiatives are very early in their life cycle and they are not so much or not at all organized yet. So what do we see behind the scenes, behind the technical perspective? Well, we see a lot of things that are happening. We see the services that are published in this area that are more and more shifting towards the API. The traditional banking services that we had available, they are shifting towards an API-based approach because, well, it's easier because it brings things faster to the market, because it allows to expose services that you already have, basically because it generates revenue. We see a lot of providers having their own developers portals. It is literally a galore of all this. Everybody is publishing his stuff, everybody is creating documentation, SDK, usage examples, and so on and so forth. Everybody a little bit in its own, right? There is standardization that is happening. We see more and more of that as well. I'm not talking about necessarily the data standardization, which is happening anyway, and it will happen because it's the industry that is driving it. But we see also standardization of the access control. We see the initiatives that are taken on the OpenID Foundation, for example, that are becoming more and more important and followed by everybody in the industry. We see, for example, an initiative like Berlin Group that developed a standard for TSD2, now beginning to be very close on adopting standards published by the OpenID Foundation, and I'm talking about the FAPI standards. So this is clearly a step in the good direction. We see service consumers beginning to integrate API of different providers to build these more complicated services that I was talking about. In this direction, these different APIs, they not necessarily come from finance area anymore. They come from various areas. So we see a mesh in this integration of offerings and services that are created with them. Of course, in this context, the hubs offerings are also extending outside the compliance area, and there's more and more stuff that is pushed there. And of course, we still see the end users, being them corporate or individual, that still have a lot of hurdles to go with. There is still not a consistent level of trust in the offerings that are available. There are still different user experiences that are available. There is different documentation that is available. So basically, it is really the time to begin concentrating more and more on the user journeys, because after all, they are the beneficiaries, but also the ones that are paying for all these services. So in this context, we begin to think in LuxHub about filling the gap, to find out what is missing, how can we help, what can we put together in this direction. So I think we can all agree in this area that we have really common goals, right? We want to deliver a better service, we want to deliver more value to our users, we want eventually to make a better business. So how can we do that? Well, I think the common denominator is what we have on this slide, basically, by defining a set of rules for admission criteria and the certification program. And this is done in a smaller or bigger measure in various initiatives that are already regulated in one way or the other. But we are, as we've seen, we are going outside the boundaries of these regulations. So we need to have something that it is global. It is not necessarily referring to one regulation or the other, but is transcending this kind of borders. We need to have a standardized access control and user journeys. Of course, it cannot be 100% because there are different journeys. There are different type of access control according to the security level of the API, according to the resources that are shared. But they can still be standardized in a few methods that are generally best practices and accepted standards from a security point of view while ensuring a good user journey. This should be basically part of the offering that the Open Finance should bring to market together with the technical connectivity and everything else. We should have well-defined business model that all the participants can play with. So it should be beneficial for the consumers, it should be beneficial for the providers, and not at last for the end user. Why would I be interested to make my data available via this kind of open models, right? What is in it for the end user? We need, of course, to ensure governance and mediation, because by putting all these players together, some rules need to be defined, as we said, and somebody needs to take charge of defining the rules and then playing judge, if you want, or jury between the participants. Of course, the participants themselves can do it. So they just need to regulate and put the proper measures and governance in place. We need to have a level playing field. We need to have the participant being able to differentiate by the offer that they are making and not by the advantages that they can get by not participating in the scheme. Of course, we need to warranty the quality of the offering, and we need to warranty the trust for the end user. I would say the paramount to all this, it's eventually the trust. If we can build the trust of the user, we can ensure the success of the platform. I'll mention in this direction one initiative that I was a signatory of, the GAIN initiative for a global assured identity network, where the financial institutions will become the warrants of this identity of participants in an ecosystem. So initiatives like this will build into the same direction, building the trust of all the participating, ensuring the quality of the services, bringing everybody together for the further benefit. Oops. How would we plan to do that? Well, we plan to build a dedicated infrastructure, basically taking care of everything that is happening in the background to allow the partners in the system to concentrate on their offering instead of having them dealing with the things that are normally behind the scenes. So we plan to offer all these background systems that you can see here together with the actual technical infrastructure to put it in place, together with the governance structures that we discussed already about. How we want to do that? By becoming this connective tissue between the participants, providing a platform that will allow us to do this, something that is 360 degrees, that will allow to take care of all the synergies in the area and to catalyze basically the evolution of the sector, become an accelerator of this area, deal with all the challenges that participants in such systems will be facing and help them succeed. This is the purpose of what we are trying to do. And this is basically a schematic of our, what we call our 360 degrees offering. It is a full cycle marketplace from the point of view, as you can see on the left side, of the evolution of this. We started with compliance. We went to Open Finance APIs, and now we want to become a marketplace for and the solutions that our consumers of APIs are actually building. So, by putting together the consumers and the providers, we will be able to ensure this level playing field, this common playground for innovation. We have a little bit of credentialing in this direction. We have the expertise of what we did so far. We are in the process of building more and getting more to see the benefits and the mutual benefits of this platform. I'm seeing that I'm a little bit going out of time, so I'll move a little bit faster. I don't have really that many slides. Again, it is the story that I said so far. I would like to concentrate maybe just on what were this last slide, actually. Okay. So basically, to just put my money where my mouth was until so far, I will show you what we have and what we are planning to have. Basically, the green...
Radu, yes. Can I hold you there? Because sure. This is all about LuxHub. And I want to keep a little bit of time to make it something that people can apply, no matter if they're a LuxHub customer or planning to become a LuxHub customer, because there's some really interesting things, knowledge that you have, I think, that other people don't really easily get access to.
Yes.
And I think the audience, like the people in the audience, probably are interested in hearing some of that. They can look at the roadmap if they're planning to become a customer.
So yes, that's one of the ideas. Basically, we don't necessarily want to have this platform just for our customers. We'd see it also in a way of open participation. Since we are talking about open finance, why not to have an open platform? Mm-hmm. So we are aiming just to make the platform available and bring traction by the participation,
uh-huh.
and not to lead it in any way or to force anybody to become a customer in order to participate.
So what I wanted to ask connected to that is because we get a lot of people asking us like, okay, we build dev portals. So people come to us to ask like, we want to build a marketplace. We want to use APIs to differentiate ourselves as a player in this new economy. And the first thing I normally say is like, be careful, this is not easy. Like making a successful marketplace is not just about publishing APIs. It's about creating a unified brand and creating something that people will recognize and come and seek out. What advice do you have for people that are looking to start a marketplace in their sector? Because you've basically done this, right? Like you've built a marketplace in the finance sector. What are the, like, how do you build brand recognition for an API marketplace?
Well, first of all, I want to thank you that coming from you saying that we already built something is quite nice, actually, with your expertise. Secondly, I think it's just about of getting traction, getting people to participate in what you are doing. The brand recognition in itself, I don't think it should be a name. It should be just an outcome. Eventually. So by providing the means, I think, and the ways to participate, for people to play together, to innovate, to put things and mutualize the cost, I think the brand recognition should be just an outcome of all that. This is what we did, basically. We never started with the scope of let's make LuxHub the best. We are just too small to do that. We tried to build the things, bring the participants to it, and then build it and they will come, right?
Yeah. It's fascinating to hear the story, like from your perspective, like how the market is evolving and how APIs are becoming more mature. It's going to be interesting, I think, to see how, like, what is the scope for differentiation that enterprises have also in this space. And like, and how can they, because there's like that balancing act that you're doing is like scaling and scope and differentiation. There was a talk from Mark Burgar earlier about economies of scope. And I think that it would be interesting to see, you know, how that connects with that.
Indeed.
Thank you very much for your talk.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing and for trying to build a more open financial sector. I think that's really valuable and very interesting. And hope to see you soon at one of the upcoming events. Thank you, Radu.
Sure. Thank you for the invitation. Great to be here. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.